Hello, my name is Darren Thomas and I am the Director of Educational Research Techniques. In this video, I'm going to give you some tips and some strategies for how you can approach helping your students to become autonomous learners. Now, that should sound kind of strange to you, you know, helping someone to become autonomous, but there are, even though it seems contradictory to help someone to become independent, there are ways that it can actually be done. So, what exactly is autonomous learning? I've already kind of hinted at it so already. Autonomous learning is helping someone to become able to learn independently. In other words, you want someone to be able to go from relying on the teacher to learn to being able to understand how they can learn by themselves. And for many educators, this is the primary goal of education. You want students to be able to leave your classroom and to be able to continue to grow, to be able to continue to learn without having to rely on the support of other people. And so as educators, many educators, this is one of our primary focuses in the classroom beyond whatever specific content we are trying to help the students with. We want students to be able to go forward and to acquire knowledge and to be able to apply that knowledge by themselves. Now, having said that, there are several ways you can do this, but I'm going to talk about three of them. And the three ways that, at least in this presentation, that you can use to help your students become autonomous or independent learners is reflection, choice, and peer teaching. So let's go through each of these one at a time. Now, reflection is primarily involving three things: examining the past, that's the first one, deciding what went well and wrong, and then planning for the future based on this, on what you've looked at from the past. And so, an example of this inside the classroom is that, you know, after the students do a major assignment, you might want to have them reflect. Hey, how did that presentation go? What went well? What went wrong? How would you do it differently in the future? This is the classic example that I have my students do multiple times whenever we have a significant assignment. So by thinking about what happened in the last assignment, students are able to see what they were strong at, what they were weak at, and also they begin to learn how to develop strategies to overcome their weaknesses for the future. This is becoming autonomous learning, not relying on other people to point out what you did wrong or what you did well, but deciding for yourself. Another way that you can encourage reflective thinking, instead of like a writing assignment where you have them write several paragraphs, is just make a list. So as after doing a major assignment, what can you do now? What new skills have you acquired? It's very similar to the one that I've already mentioned. However, the students are able to track how they have grown from a learning experience. And again, this helps them in becoming autonomous when they can see how different things helps them to grow as students and as individuals. Another way, and this is our second choice here, is choice itself. And with choice, you are teaching several different ways for students to do something. This is important, you know, different people have different learning styles and different approaches to learning. And so as an example, you might show them several different ways to do note-taking, you know, with an outline or with, you know, bubbles and charts or visual, whatever. And by doing this, it empowers a student with responsibility. They have to decide for themselves how they are going to do something. An example I use when I teach history is, as we go through the content of the course, we create different themes of what's been happening throughout history. So, for example, the theme of war as you go through the history of English, or the disease and how it plays a role in the development of a language, etc. And so through developing these themes, we are empowering the students with the responsibility of choice. How do you see the development of these particular ideas, as an example? Now, you have to use the choice option with care, because too much choice, people cannot make a decision. So you have to balance this. For example, often when I was studying math, especially at the higher levels, you know, going into upper high school and college, you know, the brilliant teacher would teach us, you know, five different ways to solve an equation. And, you know, it was so difficult just to learn one way to solve the equation that to know five ways was very, very difficult to try to understand what to do. So choice has to be used with care. And normally you use choice once the students are very, very comfortable with the fundamentals of whatever discipline you're responsible for teaching. Lastly, we're going to talk about peer teaching. Now, when students teach each other, it helps them to understand the content better. because the interaction between peers is always going to be different from the interaction between student and teacher. And so I don't think I have to define this or provide a lot of examples of this, but by having students help each other, they are able to each become more independent, especially the one that is providing the teaching assistance. And so this is the last strategy that you might want to consider to implement in your classroom as you try to empower students to become autonomous learners. So in this video, we've talked about exactly what autonomous learning is. It is helping students and providing them the ability to become independent learners, to be able to go forward without us and to continue to grow. And there are the three ways that we discussed in this video: reflection, choice, and peer teaching. So I would like to thank you for watching this video. My name is Darren Thomas, the Director of Educational Research Techniques. Thank you.